And so we want to come to our study of Ephesians, and we're looking at Ephesians 1, 13, 13, and 14. You also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believe, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. We are these days looking at this phrase, you were marked with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. And I've shared with you this verse from John 16, 13. It says, when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. What's really amazing to me is that so many people have so many different ideas of what the Holy Spirit's ministry is. This is the major one. He is the Spirit of truth. He more than anybody else. What are we doing now?
It's taped down, Kyle.
It's all right. Just let me do this. We've wasted enough time. Yes. Let's just...
Thanks.
All right. Can you get me working with this one? All right, good. My patience is being tested. I already told you that my patience is not great. We're going to talk about the fruit of the Spirit in a minute. All right, when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. You understand? Really a great promise. Now, we want to think about that. What does living in the Spirit involve? I said simply, it means the Holy Spirit is producing his fruit from within me. Now again, we get all kinds of confusing, conflicting ideas about the ministry of the Holy Spirit. This is the simplest statement I know how to make. Because he lives within us, he is producing his fruit from inside of us. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, it says the fruit of the Spirit is, and there's one of these words you want to really listen to, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. Now, you got it, didn't you? Yeah, all right. Now, what I've tried to tell you, this is not a pick-and-choose list. It says that the fruit of the Spirit is. So every one of these traits are all there. If the Holy Spirit is producing his fruit in you, you cannot say, well, I do pretty good on the love and the joy part, but I don't do good on the patience part. It's all of those. And we'll see in a minute how important that list is. So when we're walking in the Spirit, it's a matter of moment-by-moment dependency on the Holy Spirit's work, and it's evidenced by his production of his fruit in our lives. And if we're walking in moment-by-moment dependence on him, that's what we're going to see. The picture that Scripture uses is the picture of a branch abiding in a vine. And we've talked about what is the compelling evidence that a branch is actually abiding in a vine. Well, it's not just the fruit. It's fruit that is true to the nature of the vine. You see, I have at home a persimmon tree. It's quite a beautiful tree. And last year got too much fruit. And I walked out in the backyard and half of the tree was laying on the ground. And it just split right in half. And I thought, there goes my tree. And there was no way of going to recover it. If I cut that branch off, it was so ugly, you'd have to cut the tree down. So I thought, all right, I'm going to cut all the fruit off of it. I'm going to tie it back together. I'm going to get it fixed. And it healed. Now, the point that's so interesting about it is if you went and attached apple trees to that persimmon tree, would those be the fruit the persimmon tree produced? No. It produces persimmon. I want you to realize the evidence that we're walking in the Spirit is he is producing fruit that's true to his nature. Now, what is the Holy Spirit given to do? In John 15, 26, it says, when he, the advocate, comes. Now, I love that phrase. That's the descriptive term of what the Holy Spirit does. He's an advocate on our behalf, represented from the Father, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth that goes out before the Father. He will testify about who? Who's the me? Jesus Christ. John 14, 16, and 17, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and to be with you, how often?
Forever.
Forever, the Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him or knows him, but you know him, for he lives within you and will be in you. Now, I've tried to help you to really understand this piece. As a matter of fact, let me address this. I planned on it. I'm going to kind of have to adapt this message quite a bit today. One of the class came up to me afterwards and said, is God's grace sufficient for everything? And are you living in God's grace when everything's going well or when you have trial? And I said, well, 2 Corinthians 12 says in the Apostle Paul, he asked the Lord to take the thorn in the flesh away. And what did the Lord say? No. And he said, no, but my grace is sufficient for you. And somebody was talking about me in particular and said, is John having all the grace of God? And they said, can't possibly be because of all his back problems. I mean, how could you say that? That's just incredible, because God says, sometimes he says no. And in the knowing, he says, my grace is sufficient for you, implied in every situation, right? All right, how does that come? Because the Holy Spirit, who is the personification of the grace of God, lives where? At Rolling Hills Covenant Church, and if you want him, you have to come here to get him, right? And there's this little vending machine upstairs, and you put your little quarter in it, and you get the Holy Spirit, right? It says, when you were saved, the Holy Spirit took up residence in you. And we've been talking at some length about the fact that the Holy Spirit is not an influence. He is a person. And when you get him, you get all of him. The issue is, and we've been talking about this as well, does he have all of me? You can't get any more of him. God has given you all of the Holy Spirit. And you notice that? For he lives with you and will be in you. John 7, 37, 39. On the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, let anyone who's thirsty come to me and drink. And now what you need to realize is this feast, they were celebrating the provision of water in the Old Testament when Moses struck the rock. So they've been talking a lot about how God provided water. And Jesus says, if you're really thirsty, whoever believes in me, as the scripture says, rivers of water. I don't know what that is. Rivers of living water will flow from where? From within him. By this he meant the Spirit, whom those he believed in were later to receive. So what is God saying here? In the person of the Holy Spirit, we have within us the living water of Christ residing and as an artesian spring flowing from us. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. So he was given for this very purpose, to conform us to the person of Christ so that we could be effective witnesses for him and live for the praise of his glory. The power of the Holy Spirit is manifested in the believer through three different channels. The first of those is to understand and live in God's truth. I've told you that so much of the time. He is the Spirit of truth. 1 Corinthians 2, 19 to 16. What no eye has seen nor ear heard, what no human mind has conceived, the things that God has prepared for those who love him, these are the things that God has revealed to us. How? By his Spirit. The Spirit teaches all things, even the deep things of God. No one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. What we have received is not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit that is from God, so that we might understand what God has freely given us. Now let me just stop a minute here. I have people all the time saying no one can understand God's purposes. That's not true. Because the Holy Spirit has been given so that we would understand the things that are from the Lord. The person without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, but considers them foolishness and cannot understand them at all because they are discerned only through the Spirit. But now hear this. If Jesus Christ is living in you through the power of the Holy Spirit, you have the mind of Christ. And that's mind-boggling. Inside of you, all that Jesus Christ is, lives in the person of the Holy Spirit. All right, the second work of the Holy Spirit that we've been talking about is his fruit. Now, why does God give us the fruit of the Spirit? Number one, and I love this, if you don't get anything else out of today, this phrase ought to stick. It's the antidote to gratifying the spiritual nature. The sinful nature. All right, so we have, and I can't ever say it right, Ebola, am I saying that right? Is that this new disease that's so deadly? Ebola. I never quite get it right. All right. So we have a sinful Ebola disease that kills us eternally. But the scripture has given us the antidote for that in the fruit of the Spirit, Galatians 5:16. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. So if you have a problem like I do with being impatient, what is the antidote for that? The fruit of the Spirit. Walking in obedience with him, drawing upon his inexhaustible supply. Now let me just make sure you catch this. We've looked at this slide a couple of times in this series. Just look at the opposite of these words. This is coming from Galatians chapter 5. It says the opposite of the fruit of the Spirit. Okay, we have love. What's the opposite of love? It's hatefulness. Joy. Now what's the opposite of joy? It's not just sadness. It's really depression. And I'm just amazed on how prominent depression is these days. And doctors tell us it comes from imbalance in the mind. Now, it may go there, but it never starts there. It starts there. You know where depression comes from? Bitterness. Unforgiveness. Scripture says it really clear. There is always a spiritual cause for depression first that may translate into physical causes that you have to deal with. But if you don't deal with the physical causes, all the medication the doctor's gonna do is make it worse. And there's so many cases where I see that. The opposite of peace is stress. And we talk about that almost as if that's a badge of honor these days. Oh, I'm just living such a stressful life, as if that was a great thing to do. Stress is the opposite of living in the peace of the Spirit. We're going to skip this one. And the opposite of patience is what? Impatience. Opposite of kindness is rudeness, but I'm using that word in a much deeper sense. It's just an insensitivity. We'll see it later in Ephesians where it says, let no unwholesome talk come out of your mouth. Goodness is an insensitivity to what God really wants. Faithfulness is backstabbing not only us, but God. It's amazing to me. I hear it all the time. I heard it again this week. Somebody didn't obey what God said. Something very awful happened to them. And they said, where was God when this happened to me? And I wanted to say he's right where he promised to be. He's either going to be the blesser or the judge. And you chose the judge. And so he brought judgment. All right. A gentleness or roughness, self-control or controlled by the flesh. All right, so the fruit of the Spirit is the antidote to all of those fleshly things. Do you realize what great news that is? Amen. All right, secondly, it's the means by which God demonstrates his power. When a person becomes a Christian by the indwelling work of the Holy Spirit, they become a new creation. And most of you know that phrase, but I don't think most of us really understand it. Now, when I come to Ephesians 4, I guess 3 years from now at the rate we're going, I'll look at this in much more detail, but I want to do a quick run with this for you. What does it look like to be a new creation in Christ? Let some of these phrases sink in, and you can read them on your own. It's just, I'm pulling out key phrases from Ephesians 4, 17 to 25, 21. We are, the non-believer is not as futile in his thinking, Scripture says. And the person who's a new creation in Christ is no longer futile in their thinking or actions. Number two, they're putting off the old self and being made new in the attitude of their minds. They put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. A new creation Christian only speaks truthfully. A new creation Christian never is sinfully angry. A new creation Christian never steals but gives. A new creation Christian does not let any unwholesome talk come out of their mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs. They do not grieve the Holy Spirit. that get rid of all bitterness and rage and anger and brawling and slander and malice. They're kind and compassionate. They're forgiving as in Christ God has forgiven them. They walk in the way of love just as Christ loved us and gave himself for us. They do not even have the hint of sexual immorality, the hint of greed, or coarse joking. Did you get that last one? There's some in our class who need to hear that. All right, they live a life of thanksgiving. They are not deceived. They have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather they expose them. They live as children of light. They are careful how they live, making the most of every opportunity. They do not get drunk on wine, but are filled with the Holy Spirit. They speak to one another with hymns and songs of the Spirit, making music in their hearts to God. They submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. That's a new creation Christian. That's what God wants for us. So how are we doing? I don't know about you, but that's a pretty challenging list for me. All right, so when the Holy Spirit really is at work in us and producing his fruit, the only thing that we can do to describe us is, man, that's a new creation Christian. God is making them entirely new. So what will be the results of the person who's really living in the fruit of the Spirit? People will be drawn to Christ because of the fragrance of their lives. Now, I love that phrase. Do you smell like Jesus? Or do you stink like the world? And do you notice that I think an awful lot of times we stink like the world and we don't even know it? That you have the fragrance of Christ about your life. A second result of people who are really living and walking in the Spirit and seeing that fruit produced is people will persecute them. You say, wait a minute, I like that first one better. I'd rather smell like Christ. But Scripture says when we smell like Christ, we are going to be the fruit, the smell, aroma of Christ to some and the aroma of death to others. People will persecute us for the righteousness that they're seeing us because they hate Jesus Christ who is being revealed by our very lives. Number three, God will call us his treasured possession. Now, this morning we were hearing a little bit about how much God loves us. I love the passage in Malachi where God says we're his treasured possession. We'll live in harmony and humility with one another in the body of Christ. We're going to see this more in days coming. The Holy Spirit functions like oil in an engine. Without it, the friction between the parts will destroy it. I had a young man in my church in San Diego, and he bought a brand new truck. And he was, I'll never forget this. And he hadn't had it but just a few months. And he drove up to my house, and it was clattering and smoking. And he said, what's wrong with my truck? I said, let's check the oil. There wasn't any. He blew up the engine within the first 6 months of running and having his truck. It's amazing. Well, that's kind of what the church is like. Unless the Holy Spirit is working among us, the friction we're going to have because we're fallen people is going to destroy us. When believers are not walking in the Spirit, they're in conflict with each other. Philippians 2:1-8, therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, any comfort from his love, any common sharing in the Spirit, any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition, rather in humility. Value others. How? Did you notice that? It isn't just that we value others. It says we value them above ourselves, not looking to our own interest, but the interest of others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God as something to be used for his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. That is the work of the Holy Spirit. The fruit of the Holy Spirit will protect us from the destructive power of sin. 2 Peter 1:3-4. His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us his very great and precious promises. through them that you might participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. The Holy Spirit was given to equip us with spiritual gifts. Now, I've been saying over and over over these last few weeks, God never intended that the spiritual gifts were any sign of the Spirit's presence. And in the charismatic movement, they got that very wrong. The gifts were never intended that. The fruit is the evidence of the Holy Spirit. But the gifts are important. They're a gift of the Lord. You know what they're given for? What are the gifts of the Spirit for? Interdependence. Let me explain that. 1 Corinthians 12:12-27. Just as a body is one with many parts, so is the body of Christ, verse 18. But in fact, God has placed the parts of the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. God has gifted each of us uniquely to play the role in the body of Christ, to be what he wants the body of Christ to be. You are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. We're not independent operators. No lone rangers here. That's amazing to me how often we say to one another, you know, I don't really need you. You ever said that about someone? Or at least in your mind? 1 Corinthians 12 puts it this way, there should be no division in the body, but all the members should have the same care for one another. And if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. If one member is honored, all the members rejoice in it. Now, I think the first part's relatively easy. When somebody's suffering, to suffer with them. But when somebody else gets the honor and I don't, that's a little harder, don't you think? Notice that both parts are there. Now you are Christ's body and individually members of it. You cannot walk in the Spirit apart from functioning in the body of Christ. Spirit-controlled Christians do not function as lone rangers. Romans 12:10, be devoted to one another in love. Above yourselves, honor them, honor those other folks above yourselves. Galatians 5:13, serve one another. Romans 15:7, accept one another as Christ has accepted you in order to bring praise to God. 1 Thessalonians 5:11, therefore encourage one another and build each other up. It is through the gifts of the Spirit that God accomplishes his work. And I'm going to stop there because I want you to listen to this song at the end because it really captures a bit of what we're doing. So we're going to come back and pick all this other stuff up later. I usually wouldn't put so much emphasis on a song, but I feel I need to this morning. I would just really ask you to think about this as a possible prayer. If the Holy Spirit has given us his fruit as an antidote to the sins of the flesh, see if this prayer does not capture your heart this morning. Okay, Kyle, let's go. Breathe on me.
Breathe on me, breath of God. Until this earthly part of me glows with thy fire divine. Until this earthly part of me glows with thy fire. Breathe on me,
all right. So that's the work of the Spirit. We'll come back and pick up what we didn't get to next week, but be along for the fruit of the Spirit in your life. Breathe on me, breath of God. Burn away all of the sinful stuff. The Holy Spirit and His fruit is the antidote to the sins of the flesh. Heavenly Father, thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit. Forgive us that in many circles we have ignored His work. We thank you that He is the Spirit of truth, given to lead us into who you are, Jesus Christ. And the more that we're like you, then the fruit of the Spirit's going to show out of our lives. Help us to live in such vital union with you that the fruit we bear is the same kind of fruit that you bear. I pray that you would encourage those of us who are in this class who know you, Savior, to be able to say, the Holy Spirit lives within us for this very purpose. And this is what you're going to do, and we ask you would, and we commit ourselves to it, and we do it in Jesus' name. Amen.